Low ferritin is one thing, but high ferritin can be anything. Iron problems, cancer, infections, autoimmune diseases, alcohol use, metabolic syndrome, oh man. In this video, I'm gonna help you figure out why your ferritin is abnormal and show you how to fix it. Hey, I'm Dr. Tom Scheck-Snyder, and I wanna help you understand your labs and optimize your health. Because when your health is optimized, you can do anything. Let's go. What is ferritin? Ferritin is a protein that stores iron. It's in all cells of the body. When you see the name ferritin, think ferric or ferrous, which are forms of iron. You can also think of the fuzzy animal that steals things and stores them in random places. Ferritin stores iron, but it's not just a static iron warehouse. It's a dynamic iron buffer that responds to changes in the body so you don't die. That characteristic is what makes ferritin so awesome and so frustrating. Why is it measured? Ferritin is usually checked along with other iron studies to determine the cause of anemia, because 50% of anemias are due to iron deficiency. So you go to your doctor and your CBC shows anemia. The doctor orders iron studies, which include ferritin, transferrin saturation, and total iron binding capacity. If the ferritin level comes back low, that means you have low iron stores and the diagnosis of iron deficiency is confirmed. Woohoo! I love being right. Go ahead and start the treatment. By the way, if you're unfamiliar with iron deficiency, check out this video. So that's the traditional use of the test, to confirm the diagnosis of iron deficiency anemia. But what if the ferritin level comes back high? Then you and your doctor are so angry and confused because high ferritin doesn't just mean high iron. It does mean that about 10% of the time. But in the other 90% of cases, to quote Winston Churchill, it's a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma. The cause is difficult to figure out. And even worse, some of those causes are life-threatening. First, let's learn more about ferritin using the classic action movie plot. There's the good guys, the bad guys, and a bomb. The bad guys need the bomb to be powerful and to destroy the world. The good guys don't want the bad guys to have the bomb, so they spend the whole movie trying to keep it away from them. The suspense in the movie arises because, of course, we don't want the bad guys to get the bomb, but if the good guys mishandle it, the bomb could go off at any moment and kill everyone, ruining the movie and destroying the world. The good guys are ferritin, the bomb is iron, and the bad guys are the broad categories of iron overload, infections, inflammation, and cancers. I'll narrow down those categories soon, but they all cause elevated ferritin. So one or more of those conditions insults the body. The body pulls the proverbial fire alarm, which is known as the acute phase response. The liver produces ferritin in excess during the acute phase response, and ferritin's purpose is to sequester the iron bomb and keep it away from the bad guys, as well as to prevent that iron from getting out and inadvertently exploding, producing toxic free radicals that cause unnecessary damage to the body itself. It's just like the movies. Another important nuance is that the body has different levels of fire alarms. The acute phase response is the big alarm, where a person feels sick and has other abnormal labs, including elevated C-reactive protein. The body also has small fire alarms that are harder to detect, but still cause elevated ferritin. Let's talk about normal levels and then next steps you should take if your level is abnormal. Normal ferritin levels vary based on age, gender, and ethnicity, but are typically around 30 to 200 nanograms per milliliter for women and 30 to 300 for men. Elevated levels can be divided into three categories of severity. Mild is less than 1,000, moderate is 1,000 to 10,000, and severe is over 10,000. Those are rough, non-standardized, broad categories. Don't rely solely on the number. Low levels could indicate a dangerous process just the same as high numbers. Anyway, here's the next steps and we'll start with the easy one, low ferritin. Ferritin less than 30 is specific for iron deficiency. It can't be anything else. If you have a ferritin less than 30, especially if you're anemic, you're iron deficient and you should start fixing that right away. Check out episode 2 of Lab Stories and download my iron deficiency guide for specific instruction. Now for high ferritin. The first question I'd ask if you have high ferritin is, were you sick when the test was done? If so, recheck it when you're well. If it's still high after you feel well, the next thing you should do is look at transferrin saturation, which is part of the iron studies that you should already have. If it's over 50% in men or over 40% in women, then you have high iron and you need genetic testing for hemochromatosis. That'll be around 10% of people. If that's you, go ahead and like the video, jump off, and call your doctor. If your transferrin saturation is below those numbers, keep watching. Let's knock out a few obvious causes. Do you drink alcohol heavily? If yes, then that's probably the cause. The treatment is to stop drinking. And ferritin should rapidly decline unless you have ongoing liver inflammation from another cause like hepatitis, fatty liver, or permanent liver damage. Recheck the ferritin and liver studies in a few weeks. If ferritin is over 1,000, talk to your doctor today. Next, do you have an autoimmune disease like lupus or rheumatoid arthritis? Those are big fire alarm pulling diseases, and they will also have an elevated C-reactive protein when not properly controlled. If you have those diseases, they are probably the cause, and controlling them will lower ferritin. Next, do you have cancer? Lots of cancers cause high ferritin, including breast, lung, pancreatic, leukemias, lymphomas, liver, and squamous cell cancers of the head and neck. You may already know if you have cancer, but if you don't, you need to figure it out. That means exams for breast masses and enlarged lymph nodes, lab tests including complete blood counts, bilirubin and enzyme levels to assess the pancreas and biliary tract, mammograms, colonoscopies, CT scans of the lungs and abdomen, etc. I don't want to be a fearmonger on YouTube, but make sure you figure this out. Malignancies are consistently one of the most common causes of high ferritin, especially when it's over 1,000. Next question, are you on dialysis? Half of dialysis patients have elevated ferritin. That is probably your cause. Is your ferritin over 10,000? Super high ferritin levels are uniquely associated with rare severe inflammatory disorders named Still's disease and hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, which you've self-selected against having because you're watching YouTube right now and not in the ICU. But levels over 10,000 are also seen in kidney failure, some infections, liver damage, and blood cancers. If your level is over 10,000, I hope your doctor has already called you, like for real. Okay, now for the rest of us, which should be a majority. Your ferritin is under 1,000, you don't have cancer, autoimmune disease, or an infection, and you feel fine. Do you have metabolic syndrome with obesity, type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, or high cholesterol? If yes, that's probably your cause. You should immediately start optimizing your diet, exercise, sleep, and stress with plans to recheck that ferritin level in 3 months. Download my free weight loss checklist, which will help you set your metabolic house in order. In summary, low ferritin is iron deficiency. High ferritin could be many things, including infections, alcohol use, cancers, autoimmune disease, kidney failure, and most commonly, metabolic syndrome. Here's to understanding your labs and optimizing your health.